Right now, I'm going to ask Haley Berger to come up. She's going to tell you about a mission trip that she's going on, and then we'll get into God's Word, but just welcome Haley. She's going to tell us about an excursion she's going on.
Good morning. My name is Haley Berger. I have been attending Mount Zion for 7 years now. I've been in the youth group here and also helped out with the Awana program. I was born at 23 weeks. The doctor told my mom that I had a 10% chance to live. If I made it through the night, I would be blind and have cerebral palsy. God definitely had a different plan. Amen. In the past 4 years, I worked with YWAM, Youth with a Mission, in Orlando. While there, I traveled to South Africa, and I've gone to Haiti and Baja for short-term missions trips. Starting in July, I will serve as a missionary through an organization called Adventures in Missions through their World Race program. The World Race is an 11-month Christian mission trip to 11 different countries in 11 months. I personally will be traveling to Romania, Ukraine, India, Ireland, Sri Lanka, Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda, Thailand, Cambodia, and Malaysia. On the World Race, my team and I will serve in partnership with churches and ministries in local communities to preach the gospel, work in orphanages, minister to women and children in local communities, minister to women and children who are trapped in prostitution as a result of human trafficking, and bring restoration and hope of the Father's love to many tribes and nations. I also plan to invest in the communities I visit, getting to know individual people and learning from varying and diverse lives. In Matthew 10:8, Jesus says, "Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons, freely you receive, so freely give." I'm excited about going on this next journey God has for me. In order to make this trip happen, I need to raise $15,500. I've raised $6,500 so far through working at Lake Geneva Youth Camp, babysitting, and some outside donations. The $15,500 does not include traveler's insurance, personal items, and basic necessities for the 11 months. I am also in need of serious prayer for God to be glorified and for the safety and health of myself and my teammates. If you have any questions, I'll be in the back after service. Thanks.
Amen. All right, let's pray. Lord, I thank you for the courage you've given to Haley. A lot of people would look at this and just say, "I can't make it. It'll be too hard." But Lord, you've put it on her heart. And so, Father, I pray that you meet her needs. I also pray, Lord, that she is in a position where she is the one that you use to heal the sick, to raise the dead. That, Lord, she sees blind eyes that receive their sight and lame legs that jump up and leap. Lord, just protect her, guide and direct her, and Lord, just use her, I pray, as a mighty instrument of righteousness in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thanks, Haley. I've been thinking about this, you know, when Haley was speaking, all the young people that have gone out of this church that are all over the world. Some of them just stay. They don't come back. You know, they go into a place and they stay there and they minister. And so also today I want to pray, keep in mind that you see the big white church van with the trailer. The first group are going to YWAM, to Louisville. They're leaving today after worship. John's going to load up, and they're going to take off. So just be in prayer for them, and just keep praying for them, because God's going to call them out. And I really believe it's the hope of our nation. Amen? Amen. All right, today is Father's Day. We're going to be in John. Chapter 5 is where we're going to start. Now, I want you to think of something as I begin. First of all, stay in your seat. This is one of those days I wish I could lock the doors so you couldn't get out of here. And what we're going to do today is we're going to uphold a principle in God's Word that is so important. It's the role of a father in a family. And it's such an important role. And our nation is doing such a bad job at it, okay? We're just not doing well. But we're going to take God's word today, and we're going to look at the role, and we're going to look at the way it's supposed to happen, and then we're going to look at God's grace and his mercy. So if you're in here, and if you're going, man, this is hard to sit through, and this is tough, please don't leave, because we will get to the redemption and to the grace. As I thought about this message, and I see what's going on in our nation, I see how difficult this is. And I'm telling you what, there are pastors today, I talk to pastors, they go, what are you doing for Father's Day? You know, and they're like, we're not going to talk about fathers. We're just going to do what we usually do. And I'm like, man, it's okay if that's what God tells you, but I don't think that's what he wants. He wants us to look at the role of a father in a family and highlight it and see God's plan. And then see his redemption in that role, okay? So with that, we're going to begin in John chapter 5. And in John chapter 5, beginning in verse 16, this is what it says. So because Jesus was doing these things on the Sabbath, the Jews persecuted him. What I want you to know is what Jesus was doing is he healed a man on the Sabbath, and the guy took his mat. He picked his mat up and he was carrying it. And that's against the law on the Sabbath. And so they began to persecute Jesus because of what he had done. But now look at what Jesus says. Jesus said to them, my Father is always at his work to this very day, and I too am working. Verse 18, for this reason, the Jews tried all the harder to kill him. Not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. Verse 19, Jesus gave them this answer, I tell you the truth, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can do only what he sees his Father doing, because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all he does. Yes, to your amazement, he will show him even greater things than these. Now the point here is that Jesus, if you're looking in your outline, when persecuted for his actions, he gives his Father as a reference. I don't know if you mark your Bible up. Hopefully you do. You know, if you use a smartphone, I wouldn't highlight that unless you do it electronically. But I would just encourage you, go through the Gospel of John and highlight every place that Jesus says, I do what I see my Father doing. I do what my dad does. So many times in the Gospel of John, when they attack Jesus, he just goes back to his father and he passes the buck back to his dad. It's just the textbook place where he goes, hey, my dad's bigger than your dad. I'm doing what he told me. It's just an awesome truth. We go to John chapter 10 and we pick it up in verses 30 through 32, all right? Jesus says, I and the Father are one. Again, the Jews picked up stones to stone him. But Jesus said to them, I have shown you many great miracles from the Father. For which of these do you stone me? Isn't that just an awesome answer? Jesus has said to him, I do what I see my dad doing. And when they pick up stones to stone him here, he says, hey, for which of my dad's good works are you going to stone me? Once again, that first point, when persecuted for his actions, he gives his Father as a reference. The truth that I want you to see, Jesus does what he sees his Father doing. He does what he sees his dad doing. Look at your next point. Jesus' Father is perfect. If you have a case of the yeah buts, some of you are already in here going, yeah, but his dad was perfect. You're right, he was. Your next point, Jesus' deeds. They're all good deeds. They're perfect. Perfect. Now, the point is, how does it apply in our world today? And I need to tell you this. Here's what's going on in our world today. Because we live in an imperfect world, and because there are really great dads whose sons don't all turn out great, and because there are really bad dads whose sons do turn out great, we're tempted to go, no, the principle doesn't apply. And I need to tell you this morning, that's wrong. The principle does apply. The role of the father is very important. But our nation has strayed. Our nation has strayed from it. Today I want to take you back to the Word of God. I want to show you the perfect will of God. And then we'll talk about how it fits into your life and into your situation. All right? Now, your next point, how important is the role of fathering in 2013? I believe the world does not get it. I would be delighted if you would say to me, Pastor, I don't watch television, so I don't know about this, but if you do watch it or if you do go to any movies, I need to tell you they have diminished the role of the father. And when I watch sports on television and I see the commercials, they make dads look like they know absolutely nothing. And it drives me crazy. It's wrong. The father is so needed in the family. Now, you have to look this up on your own. I thought of running it for everybody to see, but just look it up. There's NBC has this ad going on. It's called Lean Forward. And this is what they say in the ad. They come out and they say, we have to come to the realization that the children don't belong to their parents. And man, when I heard that, I went, you have to be kidding me. And then they go with the thing, you know, it takes a village to raise a child. Yeah, it's good to have a village that loves all the children and wants to do everything they can, but they have it backwards. What they're doing is they're taking away the role of the mom and the dad to raise the children, and they're saying, give your children to us. The public school will do it. The government will do it. Whatever you do, don't let Hollywood do it. I read about this ad, and the people, you know, people got in an uproar, and they started writing in going, how can you say that? How can you do that? But what it's doing, in a sense, is giving parents permission. Hey, send them to us. It's okay. We'll take care of them. We're going to read statistics in a little bit. You're going to see that we're not doing very well in our nation with this, okay? So they just don't see it. How important is the role of the father? Now, it's just delightful to me because country music gets it. Whether you like country or not, they get it, all right? They understand it. They recognize the father's role. Rodney Atkins, okay, driving through town, just my boy and me with a Happy Meal on his booster seat, knowing that he couldn't have the toy till his nuggets were gone. It says, the green traffic light turned straight to red. I hit my brakes and mumbled under my breath. And his fries went flying and his orange drink covered his lap. And then it says, yeah, my four-year-old said a four-lettered word. And you know what the dad did? He said, son, where did you learn to talk like that? Listen to the chorus. He said, I've been watching you, Dad. Wow. I've been watching you. Been listening to you. You hear the words of Jesus? He said, I do what I see my Father do. I can honestly tell you, I learned to cuss at the auctions with my dad. That's where I learned to cuss. And it took me years to break that. The Spirit of God had to break that in me. I've been watching you. I love it. There's redemption in this song. Because by the end of the song, it says when he got back home, he went to the barn and he prayed for God's help. And then he says at night, When he put his boy to bed, his boy got down on his knees, and it says he prayed and he talked to God like he was talking to a friend. It's the same thing over. Son, where'd you learn to pray like that? He said, Dad, I've been watching you. I've been watching you, Dad. They recognize the role of the father in society, how important it is. And as much as we would like to take that off, I love this, man. Country music is playing right here in the sanctuary. Glory to God. If that's not confirmation, I don't know what is. Yes. It's all right. Country music. It confirms it. They recognize it. Now, your next point. Statistics confirm the impact of a father's presence, okay? Now, you can go online again. You can get a bunch of these statistics, and you can check them out, but I'm going to read some to you that I found when I looked up fatherless children. 43% of U.S. children live without their father. That's from the U.S. Department of Census, 43%. Spoke to a pastor on Friday. He said that 8 out of 10 people do not go to church and worship now on Sunday mornings. My percentage was higher than that in Lake Geneva this morning. I was riding up and down the streets, and I just said, God, give me courage. And I started stopping and asking people, do you go to church? And you know, out of 4 or 5 people, 2 of them said, one said, I do go to church every Sunday. One said, every now and then. But the other one said, no, I don't go to church. I don't go to church. It's very interesting, isn't it? 90% of homeless and runaway children are from fatherless homes. It's a government study. 80% of rapists motivated with displaced anger come from fatherless homes. 71% of pregnant teenagers lack a father, U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. 63% of youth suicides are from fatherless homes. Statistics back it up. 85% of children who exhibit behavioral disorders come from fatherless homes. 90% of adolescent repeat arsonists live with only their mother. 71% of high school dropouts come from fatherless homes. 75% of adolescent patients in chemical abuse centers come from fatherless homes. 70% of juveniles in state-operated institutions have no father. It just goes on and on. As I was reading the statistics, I came across one where it said all these statistics are wrong. And they come about just to, ridicule single moms. You know what? We don't want to ridicule single moms. I praise God for them. They work so hard and they do so much to raise up their children properly. So they came up with a whole other set, but I want to tell you their statistics aren't that much different. Listen to these. These are supposed to be the real statistics. 8 times, young people who grow up without their dad in their home are 8 times more likely to go to prison. They're 5 times more likely to commit suicide. They're 20 times more likely to have behavioral problems, 20 times more likely to become rapists, 32 times more likely to run away. They're 10 times more likely to abuse chemical substances, 9 times more likely to drop out of high school. It just goes on and on. If we go back to those first words of Jesus, I do what I see my Father doing. The statistics confirm the impact or the lack of impact. It's such an important role, all right? Your next point. The last words of the Old Testament confirm the importance of father-child relationships. All right, Malachi chapter 4, verse 6. Listen to what this says. Talking about Elijah, or the forerunner to Christ, when he comes back, it says, "He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers, or else I will come and strike the land with a curse." Church, I want to ask you a question this morning. Do you think our land is living in blessing right now? And we can see the reasons why. It's because we have not upheld the foundations that God has put in place. It is so important. I understand when it's talking about this, what he's saying is, I want you to go back to the ancient path, to the people like Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, the patriarchs, Moses. Remember what they taught us. Return to God. Get the commandments back. But I believe God knew how important families are and how important fathers are in their families. And our nation goes on like it doesn't matter. Over the past 15 years, I can't tell you how many times I've heard people tell me that it's not worth staying together with the person they're married to just for the sake of the children. And I tell them, I believe that's wrong. I believe that's wrong. You should stay together because it's God's will, but it will make an impact on your children. It will matter to them. Your next point, salvation through Jesus Christ makes us children of a perfect Father through adoption. Don't miss this point. Salvation through Jesus Christ makes us children of a perfect Father through adoption. All right, Romans chapter 8. I pray that you know Romans chapter 8. It is just one of the most awesome chapters in the Bible. And it's so important that you understand. And when it comes to the role of the Father, Romans 8, verse 15. "For you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you received the spirit of sonship." Some translations say adoption. "And by him we cry, Abba, Father." You see, when you give your heart to Jesus, when you ask Jesus into your heart, now you are in fellowship with a perfect Father who lives in heaven. Right in this text and in this truth, you have to understand it's why the enemy works so hard to ruin families and to mess up the role of the father in our society so that we don't understand how much we need a Savior and a Father in heaven. Verse 23 of chapter 8 of Romans. "Not only so, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit grown inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies." That role is so important. Galatians chapter 4, verse 6, "Because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of His Son," some translations, "the Spirit of adoption into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father." I want to make that point again. Salvation through Jesus Christ makes us children of a perfect Father through adoption. Have you given your heart to Jesus? Can you call your Father in heaven your Father? Look at your next point. Children need time and attention. Did you notice I didn't write down there, children need money, children need a fancy house, children need a four-wheeler, children need a boat, children need a mini bike. It doesn't say that. Children need time and they need attention. I'm so thankful when I was young, every time I got into trouble and got frustrated and turned around and went to run away, I ran into my dad's big belly. And he would grab me and turn me around and say, "We're going to go back now and I'll help you, but we're going to finish this thing." They need time and attention. How many people ever listened to the Great Outdoors show from WGN? Man, you know what the saying was there? If you take your son hunting, you'll never go hunting for your son. Isn't that awesome? You take your son fishing, you'll never go fishing for your son. Why? You spend time. Time and attention. Need to be there. Need to be there. A while ago, a young man came to me and he wanted me to marry him. I hadn't seen him for a long time, wanted me to officiate at his wedding. And I'm trying to figure out, is he walking with God? Isn't he walking with God? And I just said to him, you know, the thought came into my mind because I know his dad really well. I said, "Are you still in fellowship with your dad? Do you and your dad get along? Does your dad approve?" And he said, "Yes." And I said, "Okay." Because I knew that fellowship and I knew his dad had such a good faith. And as long as he was walking there and he was with his dad and they were still in fellowship, I knew he was probably in fellowship with his dad in heaven. You think about the importance of a father's role. I have a friend of mine who's been separated from his wife for like 4 or 5 years now, living in a different geographic location. But you know what? Almost every day, he goes to the place where his wife is because they have a young boy, and he spends time with that young boy. And he won't file for divorce. I've even encouraged him. I said, "You got to do something sooner or later." You know, and the only thing that would get him to file for divorce if he couldn't be with his young son. You talk about faithfulness. Because he's not going to leave. He's not going to move. We have so many young boys and girls growing up who don't have a strong father figure in their life. And they need that figure in their life. It could be you. It could be you. I'll never forget, I took a young man fishing one day. And he was from a very just dysfunctional home. My last knowledge of his dad is his dad's in prison. Most interesting thing happened, very peculiar for me, but that day out on Lake Geneva, every time I put a worm on this kid's hook and he threw it in the lake, he caught a fish. I didn't fish at all that day. All I did was bait his hook, take his fish off, and all of a sudden I looked in the live well and thought, "We're going to get too many fish pretty soon, and I'm going to get arrested, so we need to go." That doesn't happen to me. You can talk to anybody I go fishing with. That doesn't happen to me, right, Norm? Norm's going, "Yeah, he's right." And I thought, God, this is just amazing. I came off the lake, put the fish on ice, I took him out, and I bought him a hamburger. I said to him, "Tell me what your favorite food is and what's the one thing you like to do. What's the best day you've ever had in your life?" You know what he said to me? He said, I think I'm having it right now. And you know, I wish that would have made me feel good, but it didn't, because I knew that he, man, that day was not that big of a deal. He should have had hundreds of days like that. And there are so many young men and young women out there that just don't have that experience, church. It's time we get back to it. And we wake up. The last point this morning, the blood of Jesus has the potential to heal all relationships. Hear the point. The blood of Jesus has the potential to heal all relationships. You see, I had an awesome dad, but he was not perfect. I worked with him every day of my life till he died. And I knew all his faults and I knew his good points. And he had plenty of faults and he had plenty of good. But once I met my Father in heaven, I started looking at my dad through God's eyes. And then I could realize the thing I wanted to follow and the thing I had to change, which was my tongue. I've already talked to you about that. So whether you are in a situation where you and your dad is wonderful and you love him and you've taken a lot away, or if you've been in a terrible relationship, hear the point. The blood of Jesus has the potential to heal all relationships. It's what we're missing in our nation today. I prayed with a young lady probably 15 years or more ago right over here in this corner on a Wednesday night. I was working with junior hires. She accepted Jesus into her heart, and I said, now you have a Father in heaven. And her face just turned white, and she got angry, and she said, I hate my dad. Whew. I spent 45 minutes after that telling her, your dad in heaven's different than the one you've experienced here on earth. But through the blood of Jesus, there can be reconciliation. There can be miracles that happen. Heavenly Father, we come to you today in the precious name of Jesus. Lord, our nation is in such distress. You said when Elijah comes, when the prophet comes, when the word of God comes out, it's going to restore the hearts of the father to their children and the children back to their father. Lord, we know that that comes first with you. If there's one in here, Lord, that has never given their heart to you, they don't know you and they're not close to you, I pray that you would restore that heart today. That, Lord, we would be in relationship with you, that you would be our God. All the idols would fall away and we would worship you. Then, Lord, for the relationships here on earth, Lord, I ask that you would restore the relationships between fathers and sons, fathers and daughters. And, Lord, it takes a miracle work of the Holy Spirit, because somebody's got to change for the restoration to come. But Lord, I believe in the blood of Jesus. I believe in the power of your Holy Spirit. And Lord, I also believe that your truth and the role you've placed fathers in has such a part to play in our nation right now. Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, restore today. Help us, number one, to recognize the importance of the father's role. Lord, I ask you to strengthen marriages today, that husbands and wives will bring the blood of Jesus into their life and there will be healing, so that, Lord, we can stay in these relationships the way you meant them to be, Father. Lord, it says in your word, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Holy Spirit, come and take away any condemnation in here today. But Lord, give us hope and victorious redemption in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you need prayer, I'd love to pray for you. If you need time at the altar, there's time to come to the altar. If not, you're free to go in peace to love and serve the Lord. God bless you. Amen.